My name is Bradie Crandall. I'm a chemical engineering student from the University of South Carolina, and I'm worried about your fuel. We all got here in a car today, right? Unless you drive an electric vehicle, chances are that car is powered by petroleum. Petroleum provides more energy to the U.S. than any other single energy source. We're currently in the middle of an energy transition due to climate change. However, until we're all driving electric vehicles, we're stuck with petroleum. Carbon pollution aside, there's another big problem with what we put into our cars. Sulfur. The high sulfur content of petroleum causes acid rain that degrades forests and corrodes man-made structures. Sulfur is also responsible for thousands of cases of lung disease and asthma every single year. This is why the EPA currently mandates that the sulfur content in gasoline must fall below 15 parts per million. But if combusting sulfur has such devastating health and environmental consequences, why not mandate 0 parts per million or ultra-deep desulfurization? Right now, we rely upon a chemical process called hydrodesulfurization to remove sulfur from our fuel. The issue with this process is you need unreasonably high temperatures and pressures to achieve ultra-deep desulfurization and hit that 0 parts per million. My work has involved a new process called adsorptive desulfurization to overcome this challenge. Today, I'm going to tell you a little bit about how this process works, teach you about the materials used in this process, and share the results from my research with you. Adsorptive desulfurization allows us to produce sulfur-free fuel in a cost-effective manner. It does this by working at ambient conditions, allowing us to reuse the adsorbent material. In this process, sulfur-rich fuels flow over an adsorbent that selectively adsorbs sulfur compounds. Now, it's important I clarify. I'm talking about adsorption here, not absorption. Adsorption involves the adhesion on the surface of a material, whereas absorption involves the dissolution into a material. When I first arrived at Oak Ridge, I was tasked with identifying a good candidate adsorbent. I chose a type of a material called a zeolite. For those of you who are unfamiliar, zeolites are naturally occurring structures that form these beautiful nanoscale silica alumina frameworks. Now, scientists have figured out how to produce these materials synthetically in a lab. They've come up with so many different types of zeolites that the International Zeolite Association was formed just to keep track of the hundreds of different unique structures. Zeolites have an incredibly high surface area, and they possess strong acid sites that will interact with sulfur compounds. Most importantly, they have an ultra-high porosity that allows a large amount of sulfur to enter their framework. Zeolites are covered with what material scientists call micropores. Micropores are pores that range in diameter from 0 to 2 nanometers. Like the surface of an eggshell, the pores on the surface of a zeolite are invisible to the naked eye. In my work, I wanted to try to incorporate mesopores, or pores that range from 2 to 50 nanometers, into my zeolite. Why? If you think of sulfur entering the channel of a zeolite, like cars on a road, mesopores are highways. They allow sulfur to get where it needs to go more efficiently, thus promoting adsorption. Previous methods to incorporate mesopores into zeolites have damaged the stability and reduced the acidity of the materials. We've discovered a new method that allows us to maintain the stability and preserve these acid sites. The stability of these materials is critical, and I cannot emphasize this enough. Because if the stability is too low in these materials, the framework of the zeolite collapses. They're regenerated at around 550 degrees Celsius to reuse the materials. Now, our materials were able to withstand these high temperatures without any issues. We then took and tested these materials in a model fuel to determine their adsorption capacity, or the total amount of sulfur they could adsorb. We compared these results to a conventional zeolite, and we saw that our new structure could increase adsorption capacity by up to 22%. We then took and tried to incorporate silver into the framework of the zeolite. We did this using a method called a liquid ion exchange, where silver ions are exchanged for hydrogen ions in the framework. Now, although silver is more expensive than metals like copper, does not require any expensive reductive pretreatment in hydrogen gas. This is extremely cost advantageous for the commercialization of the material. So we then took our silver mesopore zeolites and tested it in a model fuel like before. And we saw a whopping 30% increase in adsorption capacity could be achieved after the silver ion exchange. This is on top of the 22% increase we already achieved just by incorporating mesopores into the zeolite. So until we develop alternatives to petroleum, this research could be the only thing standing between us and sulfur pollution. I've now shared a little bit about adsorptive desulfurization, zeolites, and my research here at Oak Ridge. Hopefully, you now all understand the importance of this work. Thank you.